one can't preempt these things. Should they justify? Should it be justified? Or is it justified? No, it's not justified.
Well, it doesn't take away the fact that information about the pineal gland is not readily available in the textbooks, does it?
No, it doesn't take that away. But I can't say that they have looked in... I don't think they've looked at the evidence very seriously, but I have drawn their attention to the fact that the pineal information is not there anymore. I can't say that I've done that with the psychiatrists in the past. I didn't actually go on about the pineal too much, or really about my brain, the research that I'd done to them, simply because I recognise that challenging their paradigm is not a very good, not a very wise thing to do if they're not receptive to the information. You can't, if people have a closed mind about something, me talking about something that they don't understand will be construed as madness.
So how will you argue your case then?
It depends on what questions they ask, and I'll have to frame it in reference specifically to the statement of the psychiatrist as to what evidence they have or what evidence they think they have that I'm actually mad. Previously, I'd have to give a bit of a background on that I was initially diagnosed as having a condition called hypomania. Hypomania means that you're not manic, you're less than manic. And it specifically says in the DSM that hypomania is not accompanied by psychosis. In other words, and it can be diagnosed in people who talk too fast and have an increase in goal-directed activities and have a reduction in their sleep.
Now, it's very odd in our competitive-driven society that asks you to work more and be goal-driven and achieve your ideals in life.
Yeah, it seems somewhat contradictory, seeing as that's what most positive thinking counsellors or psychologists or whatever it is, what they try and achieve for their...
So you can be goal-driven but not too goal-driven.
Yeah, well, it's to do with change. If you suddenly change in any way, really, psychiatry has got a fundamental tenet known as a premorbid personality, which is what you were like before you changed. So if a person's been, say, very, very shy or very quiet, starts becoming more outspoken, a person suddenly has a change in their level, the amount that they sleep, the amount that they talk, say somebody suddenly gets excited about something. These were sort of the reasons that people get diagnosed as being hypomanic. In Australia, I've noticed a particularly lackadaisical approach towards diagnosis. So quite often, people within the psychiatric system will have many different diagnoses put onto them, and the psychiatrists don't really see this as a contradiction. They just are prepared to accept any of these diagnoses and just put these labels onto people. But the basic distinction is really between mad and sane. And that's all it is. They're just different words for calling people mad. And the particular objection that I have and the particular thing that I'm trying to draw attention to is the fact that these are said to be genetic chemical imbalances. That's where the whole argument is that they come up with all the time. You know, you're sick and you've got a chemical imbalance. Seems extraordinary that they call it a chemical imbalance rather than a psychological imbalance, or even an electrical imbalance, because the brain involves electricity as well as chemistry. But to me, that is a reflection on how much the chemical paradigm has taken over the neurosciences. And of course, the chemical paradigm pushing has been by the pharmaceutical industry, because they've got chemicals to treat the chemical imbalances. So the chemical control over the neurosciences is something that has been all pervasive in the way doctors learn. So the other point that you asked earlier about what are the implications for doctors in the future, well, it depends on whether they wake up and there's a general awakening up to the amount of misinformation that is currently prevalent in the medical courses. And not so much a combination of misinformation and also just omitted information about stuff that they really ought to know about. My argument has been now for a couple of years that the chemistry is not unrelated to the behavior, so that a person who's happy due to a psychological reasons, say something good happens, they feel happy, or say they start perceiving things in a different way, somebody gives them some advice about how to see the beauty in the world and they start noticing the beauty in the world and they start feeling better, you will get corresponding chemical changes, so that levels of, say, noradrenaline, serotonin will actually increase. And they have found that in monkeys and in university students, that people who had an increase in self-esteem through successful completion of tasks actually had a raised serotonin level from that. This is something that is generally denied by the current paradigm.
So this gives physiological evidence for psychologists.
It does. Yeah,
that's the split between the psychologists and the psychiatrists.
Yeah, there's a big split between psychologists and psychiatrists.
And you as a GP are caught in the middle there.
I as a GP have found myself to be able to scientifically validate the position of particular groups, schools of psychology, and totally contradict the pseudoscience of psychiatry.
So with that in mind, what are the statistics of those that have appealed the community treatment order at the Mental Health Review Board?
Well, I heard from the Mental Health Review Board, the Mental Health Legal Centre, about 2 years ago, a year and a half ago, that 7 out of 200 people had got off. I don't know whether things have changed. I don't think things have changed that much. But
how
I
many
think
doctors have been before the Mental Health Review Board? There's 207 cases.
Yeah, I mean, I'm sure there are more since then. I mean, we're talking about rather old-ish statistics. But I can't say I know. I don't know, certainly, I don't know of any other cases of a doctor who's been researching psychiatry and the brain being called mad by psychiatrists who happen to be the very profession that I'm critical of. It seems somewhat unreasonable, and that appears to be the something that is the senior members on the Medical Practitioners Board are waking up to, that it's not really possible for me to get an unbiased hearing from psychiatrists because I'm basically disagreeing with their entire paradigm of how they diagnose people and the criteria that they use for diagnosing people. I've been basically looking at prejudices involved in calling people mad and the stigmatization process, and also the linguistics of it. So there are particular words that you can't use to a psychiatrist because it automatically just clicks a button in their,
like conspiracy,
their heads. Like conspiracy, yeah. So they'll actually specifically ask you in different ways, trying to get you to use the word conspiracy so that they can then equate that with paranoia. So you had to be somewhat careful about using particular words to psychiatrists, but it does depend on the psychiatrist to some degree. I mean, some of them are more open-minded than others, but if you come out there and challenge their entire paradigm, in a short period of time, maybe given many months of doing it and them going through discovering the same things and looking critically at the information that they learnt, I'm sure they would wake up to it as well. And there are psychiatrists who have woken up, people like Peter